Bismillah ar-Rahman, very warm welcome on the margin of this three-day conference on sustainable development, which is Sustainable Development Conference. We have fortunately have a very important guest whose mission and the task is to pursue social and economic development of this region and similarly other 62 countries. Obviously, without social development, economic development become meaningless or it become marginalized. So inclusive growth is a new buzzword, and now it includes environment as well, because that can reverse the all the gains at the global level. We have today with us Dr. Shamshad Akhtar. Ma'am, very warm welcome. She had been the governor of the State Bank of Pakistan. Before that, she was at a senior position in Asian Development Bank. And right now, she is the Under Secretary General of UN ESCAP, which is the Regional Commission on Economics and Social Affairs. Ma'am, very, very warm welcome. Before asking you other questions, I would like to ask you, what is the basic premise in few words?
Of the sustainable development. Well, first of all, thank you for having me here. I think the key thing that we need to recognize is that the United Nations has a mandate to develop global development agendas, and it has to its credit pushing the Millennium Development Goals for quite some time. And the Millennium Development Goals have been in the business for a couple of decades already, and now we have had a mixed progress on Millennium Development Goals. We do have some unfinished agenda, but since the time period for Millennium Development Goals was expiring, United Nations a couple of years back launched a work process for designing the next generation of development agenda, which has been now called the Sustainable Development Goals. And the difference between the Millennium Development Goals and Sustainable Development Goals is that Millennium Development Goals were 8 in number, and they talked about specific sectors, but the sector development or targets were operating in silos and segregated, while Sustainable Development Goals is a holistic integrated development agenda, and it attempts to recognize the interdependence and interlinkages between the three core pillars of RioPlus20, which is the economic, social and environment. And it advocates basically a coordinated development agenda across these three pillars, which ought to move in a self-reinforcing and mutually reinforcing manner.
Ma'am, two very important thing on the basis of which this development has to take place, at least at the global level. Global energy prices are very volatile, both upward and downward as well, and it has a very profound and very great impact on development for various reasons which need not to be explained. And then the global trade, the global demand is not picking up, and this, I mean, just going down of this global demand has effect on the interest rate, and so it's very difficult unless these two things, energy prices and the global demand and trade as a complement, as a corollary, are not tackled, how this is possible to pursue this sustainable development agenda? Or would it be very difficult for the UN at least?
The short answer is, of course, it's critical that the global growth scenario is fixed as soon as possible. We do know that in the last few years, of the concluding few years of Millennium Development Goals, since 2008, we've had a massive global economic and financial crisis, which really resulted in a collapse of growth, resulting in recessionary trends and negative or contraction of growth.
Europe is primarily responsible for that.
All the advanced countries were hit by the global economic and financial crisis. Not only was there slowdown, but there was a contraction in GDP output. And till to date, we have not been able to reach the pre-crisis growth trends in any part of the world, by and large. Pre-crisis growth. We have had huge level of prosperity worldwide prior to the crisis. So we do know how to manage things, but I think this global economic and financial crisis was a rude awakening. And of course, whenever you face crisis, it derails the most essential parts of the development agenda. One is, if you have contraction in global growth or in a country's growth, you automatically have your hard-won socio-economic gains are lost. So contraction of output is not very healthy for social economic progress, not only going forward, but it also brings it to a lower level relative to where we were prior to the contraction. So one of the points I have underscored is that global growth and growth at country level is a prerequisite for sustainable development agenda implementation. But it's not just about global growth as per se, it's the fact that you need a higher, sustainable, balanced and effectively what we call inclusive growth, so that the benefits of the growth filter to all the communities, people, and it is managed in a way that it is sustainable. Because we do know that some countries which had exceptional high growth had a mid-course correction. Their growth rates came down also, but also the carbon emissions that they emitted have actually polluted not only their own boundaries but globally. So right now, anchored in within sustainable development agenda is also the element of environment. And we are very fortunate now that United Nations is not just talking about sustainable development goals as per se, but it's talking about the means of implementation to implement these goals. It's talking about what needs to be done on climate change. It's talking about what needs to be done to resolve the stalemate in the Doha trade round.
Ma'am, we just grew up by listening that it's a marriage between internal combustion engine and hydrocarbon which is responsible for the growth. Now you're talking about sustainable growth where carbon emission is a very serious problem, automatically meaning by that you are digressing or at least moving towards the alternate energy demand. Do you think the current established players are going to resist you, including the governments, because they have, for example, if the current change in the oil prices, if the oil prices come down below the $70 a barrel, shale gas production become unviable for the United States, and the dream of becoming independent, becoming an island, this cannot be materialized. And at the same time, when the oil prices are gone down, the Russia has suffered immensely, $150 or $170 billion in this very short run, and they are by and large single commodity. I mean, they depend a lot on their energy and hydrocarbon exports. So do you think it's very difficult, the governments are going to resist all this? And we have seen as an example what happened to the Doha development agenda for this precise reason.
Well, there are several elements in your expose and in your commentary. Let me tackle one of the most essential elements of it. There has been this myth that if you are to achieve high growth, that you need to necessarily follow the hydrocarbon exploitation route. I think empirical evidence has now proven that, of course, there is a trade-off between global growth and environmental tensions exist there. But there is, with the emerging technologies, particularly sustainable technologies, now that trade-off can be managed effectively, which means you can actually continue to grow at a fast rate without recklessly hurting your environment. Now, how do we go about doing it? Science and technology has done wonders. We know ICT revolution has occurred, but at the same time, today you have renewable energy sources, which involves solar power, wind power, and biogas and several others. New frontiers are being broken as we speak. Coal, you also, which is the major polluter in United States, in China, Australia's of the world,
even in India,
basically we also have technologies for it, which is the clean coal technology. The problem that we face right now worldwide is that because demand has been low, the prices are high of these technologies. Most of the countries that are very serious in this have adopted a 20% target to move from the fuel based to kind of renewable energy sources. And some countries are making very good progress on renewable energy. The problem is the technology is expensive. Now, what we need to do is focus on really bringing the cost of renewable energy down and making sure that we are making this technology available, not only in cost-effective way, but across the developing countries which do not have the funding for it. Second issue that you talked about, the oil prices. Of course, oil price volatility is a historical reality. It's not happened for the first time. We've had very high oil price periods and we have had low price periods. It so happens that the markets react very fast on these things. The bottom line is lowering of oil prices is very good for a number of oil importing countries, and it hurts the oil exporting countries. My perspective is that when you had high oil prices, exporting countries who were prudent had conserved their proceeds that they earned from and were judiciously using the natural resources, resource mobilization. However, there were others who ended up investing the natural resource extraction funds or export proceeds in a reckless manner in real estate and on consumption and in real estate building mega rather than in real development. So whose fault is it? Now export of hydrocarbon will definitely hurt countries that have excessive and reckless dependence and lack economic diversification. But I have even heard a number of leaders talk about it, that it's a good opportunity for us. It forces us to follow the path of economic diversification, because investing in hydrocarbon,
that would be a long term. I think Saudi Arabia is not listening to the OPEC, and they are recklessly pumping out billions of barrels.
That's not true. Saudi Arabia is also diversifying and has actually invested in renewable energy. But because everybody is realizing that hydrocarbon resources, one, depletion is not a great thing over the period. Second, that it is a polluter. Third, it doesn't generate jobs for people. So you could be a rich country, but you could have very high unemployment rate. What good is money?
Very exclusive growth.
Yeah. What good is money if you can't feed your people and can't give them adequate salaries and a good standard of living? So, and it's not possible to forever say, you know, I'm going to give everybody $100,000 per year and let them enjoy their lives. This is not a sustainable model. I mean, I'm exaggerating a bit, but it's not a sustainable model to just give handouts to people and say, well, I can afford it, so let me consider this as a transfer mechanism for my domestic resources.
Towards the fag end of this interview, just two quick questions. One, we have seen the Doha development agenda. We were all very hopeful, but what happened to that, you know, much better than us. And the second is, what would be your message for Pakistan?
Well, Pakistan, I think, is a very open regime. It has a very open trade regime. It has done pretty well in liberalizing a number of economic sectors. I think what Pakistan needs to do more than anything else is to provide a level playing field and an effective policy environment for domestic and foreign investment. Pakistan is not new to multinational corporations. We know all the big names have been in Pakistan, all the big banks, global banks have been in Pakistan, have had business here. But political, economic stability, social stability are critical for Pakistan, and most of all, a transparent and if well-governing government is a prerequisite for helping this country come out of what I would call a situation where poverty remains pretty pervasive and social issues are quite endemic. People need good housing, people need good clean water, you do need proper sanitation standards here. I think it needs to focus. Government needs to focus on providing basic services. Government needs to provide a very open, level playing environment for private sector. I know it's easier said than done, but a number of countries have already done. You look at the results of what's happening in Mexico. A very young generation of leadership is there. And no matter what the challenges Mexico faces, they are steadfast on their structural reforms. And of course, it's not just about federal government. You know, since the 18th Amendment, we have transferred all the social and environmental responsibilities to the provincial governments. And provincial governments lack the capacity and know-how. And they should bring in smart people to help them manage the process of development. It can't continue the way this is going on. And I speak on this not as UN, I speak of it as a Pakistani, because I think it's very important that we invest in the welfare of the people. Less is being spent on the welfare of the people than what is needed. We think we are spending.
Yeah.
But you know, in China there is this famous saying that rather than give fish all the time, it is better to teach people on how to catch it. And you know, China is known for its very sound proverbs through the various generations.
And from Confucius.
And you know, President Xi used this very recently in one of his messages in our interaction again. And I think that's what Pakistan needs to do, that rather than just give handouts to people, is to make sure they make people learn on how to earn. You go to any country, small and medium enterprises are thriving.
Yeah.
Micro industry is thriving. I mean, I've been in Bangkok for 8-9 months, I've been 15 years in Manila. It's a very fertile ground for small, medium enterprises and microfinance. And they are both known for giving you, one, women empowerment, second, employment generation. And look at this country. We have so many women here. And look at our female labor force participation rate. If you were to invest in your women, your economic growth would be something different. If you actually make the women participate.
Yeah, the whole family participate.
Yeah, so whole family has to participate in economic growth, production machine.
Ma'am, thank you very much for giving us time and talking so fresh from the level of policy making. Definitely as a Pakistani, it's an honor and it's a privilege that somebody is devising a policy which, and when the policies would be there, the policy would be just right for Pakistan, with which we come to the end of our programs and we'll back to the conference.